All right, so I think we'll start. Okay, so basically the session, why I chose this topic was because it's a very important topic, both for your exam point of view, those writing final year exam, and also it's a very important topic from your NEET, PG, INICT point of view, because this is a very new thing. It's been in the pipeline since almost 2 years, and finally in October, this act came to be implemented with all the rules and regulations in place. So I made a brief presentation about what every student should know, at least from the exam point of view. If you either get a theory question or if you get asked as an MCQ, you should know the main points which I have put across. Okay, so if there's any doubt, you can stop me in between. In the end, we have a small interactive session, okay, where I'll just be questioning you on just a few things to see if you've understood very well. So this is just the process to explain how actually what actually happens. This even I never knew. We probably studied it in school in civics, but then so what happens when a law is to be introduced or an amendment has to happen? First, the cabinet has to approve the bill. So this happened last year in 2020 January. The cabinet approved the bill, and then what happened was in March the bill was introduced in the Lok Sabha, and this was quickly passed in around 2 weeks time. But then COVID struck. So because of COVID, there was a 1 year delay in the process of getting it passed in the Rajya Sabha, but finally that happened this year. And then once the bill is passed in both the Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha, what happens, it has to be officially, the official notification has to come. You all know about the Gazette of India. It was published in the Gazette, but following this, the rules were not yet defined. That is what is most important. We need to know what are the changes, what are the main rules, so what needs to be done, how it needs to be done. All that was defined in the MTP amendment rules. So the rules came out, and this has come out on 12th October 2021. So remember this date, 12th October 2021 is when this MTP Act has actually been now implemented. That is, the amendment has been implemented. Before this, we all know, I think all of you hopefully know, the MTP Act originally came in 1971. Right, but it was implemented on 1st April 1972, and this has come as a question previously. Okay, so you should know it came into being in 1971, but implemented in 1972, following which there was one amendment in 2002. Okay, and this amendment basically did not have any very significant changes. They just changed the name from lunatic to mentally ill. So a patient who was lunatic, this terminology was changed. It was decentralized. So district level committees were made. Okay. And it was made a punishable offense if a person who is not recognized is doing it, or if a place which is not recognized is doing it. It was made a punishable offense. So these three changes came into the 2002 amendment. And now in 2021, this amendment has very, very major changes, and that is why it is important. All right. So 1971, 1972, 2002, and 2021 are important years to remember. Okay. Now, mainly what has changed. So the previous law, I think you all know the previous law. I won't stress on it too much. Although, of course, I will keep mentioning what the previous law stated and what are the amendments. So the first major change was that contraceptive failure was an indication. The previous law, we all know that, but it was applicable only to married women. But now unmarried women are also covered in the latest amendment. So this is the first major change. Remember this. We all remember the indications. I think in the previous law, it was if there's a threat to life of the mother, a threat to physical or mental harm to the mother, a threat to threat to the fetus, if the fetus is born with a fatal anomaly, or if it is a case of rape, or if there's contraceptive failure. So these are the five main indications under which MTP was applicable in the previous law. So the last indication, that is contraceptive failure, that was applicable to married women. Now unmarried women also get covered under the latest amendment. Now second major change. So this was the first change. The second major change is the gestational age limit. So this is also very important. So remember, 20 weeks, we all know in the previous act, right? The new act says two things. Number one, in select conditions, it is 20 to 24 weeks. That is, the upper limit has now been increased by a month. That is by 20 to 24 weeks. And why this has happened is because many countries the world over, especially in the West, the 24 weeks is usually the upper limit, and many anomalies, many certain other conditions also have now been permitted. So it is not applicable to all the conditions which were there previously till 20 weeks. Only select conditions, and I'll mention these conditions, what are they, have now been included under the ambit of this 20 to 24 weeks. Okay. And beyond 24 weeks, it also includes anomalies which are very severe or incompatible with life, okay, beyond 24 weeks also. So for anomalies, there is actually no upper limit. Okay, so for fetal anomalies, there is no upper limit. But for other conditions, that is select conditions, it is 20 to 24 weeks. Okay. All right. Okay, so first major change, I'll repeat, contraceptive failure was previously applicable to married women, now it is applicable to unmarried women also. Second major change is the upper limit was 20 weeks, now it is 24 weeks, but for select conditions, and beyond, there is no upper limit for fetal anomalies. Okay. The third major change is, initially, I think you all know this, one RMP opinion was required if a woman wants to undergo MTP till 12 weeks, and two RMPs opinion was required for till 20 weeks. Now it's changed. One RMP till 20 weeks and two RMPs, the opinion is required for 20 to 24 weeks. And the last major change is the punishment has slightly changed. So this is for breach of woman's confidentiality. So if you're not supposed to tell the patient's name to anyone. Okay. It is only in the documented paper that is there. That file is then put under lock and key. It is not to be declared to anyone unless the court asks for it. All right. So if you breach the confidentiality, there's a fine of up to 1,000 rupees, but now and or imprisonment of 1 year has been added. So these are the four changes which you need to know. I'm repeating it again. Indications, contraceptive failure was added to unmarried women also. Gestational age limit has now changed in select conditions up till 24 weeks and beyond 24 weeks. So that means there's no limit for a fetal, significant fetal anomaly. One RMP opinion now till 20 weeks and two RMP for 20 to 24 weeks. And they have added an imprisonment of 1 year for breach of confidentiality. Okay. Now, just this is the same. This has not changed, but I just want to tell you what an RMP is. An RMP is basically someone who is registered under the Medical Council Act 1965. The name is in the state medical register and has had training and experience for MTP as prescribed. What is that training? Either you have a PG degree in obs and gyne or diploma, okay, or you have done 6 months of house surgency in obs and gyne, or you are an MBBS and have at least 1 year experience in the practice in obs gyne at any hospital that has all facilities. So if you have any of this, you are an RMP who can perform an MTP. Okay. Now, there's also a new thing which is now called a medical board. Okay. This is basically applicable to those fetuses who are more than 24 weeks who have a substantial fetal anomaly. Me or you can't decide that we have to terminate this pregnancy. If a woman comes, say, at 26 weeks, okay, say with a tetralogy of Fallot, a significant anomaly which is or a congenital diaphragmatic hernia, and the patient wants to terminate, I can't say because MTP Act mein 24 weeks ke baad likha, so I can do an MTP. No, it will go to a medical board. So every district now has to have a medical board, and I will refer the case to the medical board. So the medical board consists of a gynecologist. Okay, and this you should know. Okay, who is going to be in this medical board? A gynecologist, a pediatrician, a radiologist, or a sonologist, and any other member as approved by the state government. So suppose a 26 weeks woman comes with a diagnosis of congenital diaphragmatic hernia at 26 weeks. I will refer the patient to the medical board. I will not take the decision myself. Okay, and even if it's an anencephaly, even if it's an anomaly not compatible with life, I cannot take the decision. I will refer the patient to the medical board. Okay. And what does the medical board do? The medical board will decide whether to allow or deny MTP beyond 24 weeks gestation. Okay. And only after consideration that the procedure should be safe for the woman. So it should be a safe procedure. And whether the fetal malformation has substantial risk of being considered incompatible with life, or if the child, if born, may suffer from severe physical or mental abnormalities to be seriously handicapped. So in other words, it has to be a substantial fetal anomaly. If a patient comes at 26 weeks with a cleft lip, it is unlikely that the board will give permission. So it has to be a substantial risk of having the baby to be seriously handicapped, okay, or incompatible with life. Okay, so the people in the board, if they require the opinion of a cardiologist or a gastroenterologist or any other pediatric surgeon or whoever, they may want to seek an opinion, they can seek an opinion from that person also. Okay. So the board will examine the woman and her reports. They will provide the opinion. Okay, within, so if the patient, so you can't, it's a time bound process. Okay, so within 3 days of application of the request for MTP, the board has to give the decision of yes or no. And within 5 days of the request being received, the MTP has to be carried out. So it's a time bound procedure. Remember, 3 days and 5 days. 3 days for giving a decision of yes or no, the medical board has to give, and 5 days for whether to do of doing the MTP. The MTP should be done within, if it is yes, the MTP should be done within 5 days. So remember, 3 days and 5 days. Okay, now the indications. Let's go back to the indications. Okay, so what has changed? So less than 20 weeks is the same as the previous MTP Act. So what are the indications? To save the life of the mother, to prevent grave physical mental injury to the mother, if there is a risk of physical or mental abnormality to the baby in case of a rape victim, and contraceptive failure. So these five remain applicable as was in the previous act, okay, before the amendment. Okay, so less than 20 weeks, we have five indications: save the life of the mother, if to prevent grave physical mental injury to the mother, risk of physical or mental abnormality to the baby, if it's a rape victim, or if it's contraception failure. So what has changed is now 20 to 24 weeks. So remember I had said select indications. Okay, so what are those select indications? One is survivors of rape, incest, sexual assault. Okay. Second is if it is a minor. Okay, if it's a minor girl, even till 24 weeks, we can allow an MTP. If there is a change of marital status during the ongoing pregnancy, say she's a lady who suddenly became widowed at 21 weeks, she decides not to continue the pregnancy because it will cause her grave mental trauma. Okay, or say she gets divorced at 22 weeks. Okay, so this also is now included. This was not there previously. So change of marital status during the ongoing pregnancy, but only till 24 weeks. Okay. So all these are till 24 weeks only. Then women with physical disabilities, okay, as per the Disability Act, okay, this is also now under 24 weeks. Then again, fetal malformations comes here, and women in humanitarian settings or disaster or emergency situations as declared by the government. So say the COVID pandemic, okay, so maybe it's a government, this is the government will decide. So the government decides, yes, this is a humanitarian situation, or this is, or say there's a war-like situation. So the government will decide that this is a war. So in such a situation, under humanitarian settings, it can be allowed till 24 weeks. So let me repeat, what are the select conditions till 24 weeks? If it's a survivor of sexual assault, a minor, if the woman becomes widowed or divorced between 20 to 24 weeks and she wants an MTP, women who has a physical disability, fetal malformation, and in humanitarian settings or disaster, earthquake, war, all these things come under here. Now, beyond 24 weeks, there is only one indication. So please remember, fetal anomaly is the only indication beyond 24 weeks. So for if there's a fetal anomaly, there is no upper limit. Okay. This is very important to remember. So beyond 24 weeks, only and only if there is a fetal anomaly. And who will decide? The medical board will decide. Nobody else can decide, only the medical board. If it is between 20 to 24 weeks, two RMPs are required to form an opinion. If it is less than 20 weeks, only one RMP is enough. And these indications are the same as the previous act. Sorry. and 20 24 weeks are the select indications which you should know: sexual assault, minors, divorced, widowed, disabilities, fetal malformations, and war humanitarian like setting. Okay, so this slide is very, very important. Okay, so again, whose consent? This is the same. This hasn't changed. Only the patient's consent is required. Husband's or partner's is not required. It never was required. Okay, this has not changed. It's the same. I'm just putting it to emphasize only the patient, unless she's a minor or she's mentally retarded. Okay, so otherwise, only the patients. This is important to remember. Husband or partner's consent was never required. This has not changed in this amendment also. Okay. Where can an MTP be performed? This again has not changed. Any hospital established or maintained by the government, and the place has to be approved by the district level committee. So this also has not changed. Okay. Okay. So documentation has changed a bit. Okay, so it is mandatory to fill and record information in the following form. So this form C was the consent form by the patient. This also has not changed. Form C, pehle tha, still there. This is the patient's consent. So you can remember C for consent. This is unlikely to be asked in the exam, to be honest. But I've still put it for sake of completion. Those who are interested in remembering this can. Form C is patient consent form. And then there are three forms for the RMP opinion. Okay, so less than 20 weeks is form I, 20 to 24 weeks is E, form E, and medical form, the form which is filled by the medical board is the form D. How do you remember this? IED. What is IED? What is the full form of IED? Improvised explosive device. Okay, so that's one way you can remember it. This is this MTP Amendment Act is actually quite an explosion in obs and gyne circles. So IED, less than 20, 20 to 24, and more than 24. Okay, you can remember it that way, if those who want to remember. And C for consent, this is the patient's form. Okay, opinion form is IED. This is how form C looks like, just to show you how it is. Okay, and this is for how form I looks like. These were there previously also. All right, what has changed is form E and form D, because this was obviously not there before. The 20 to 24 weeks was not there, beyond 24 weeks was not there. So this is form E and this is form D. So you can see here in form D, you have to, the medical board has to give the opinion on the findings. Okay, and then finally they have to write allowed or denied. And they have to give a justification for the decision, and they have to give a physical fitness for the woman. Is she fit enough to undergo the MTP or not? Okay, so then they have to write their names and sign. So this is very, very important, whether the woman is fit enough to undergo an MTP and whether the board allows or denies the MTP. So this is form D. Form D is very, very important. So form I for the less than 20 weeks, form E for 20 to 24 weeks, and form D for more than 24 weeks. Okay, so this ends the presentation, but just for a just to see if you've understood what the main changes were, I'm giving certain scenarios. Okay, you can unmute and tell me, or you can write in, preferably unmute and tell me rather than writing in the chat box, either way, whatever you prefer. So who should form, can, number first question for each of the scenario which I show, who can perform an MTP, who should form the opinion? And first of all, can an MTP be done under this MTP amendment of 2021? Okay, first scenario, 9 weeks blighted ovum. Yes or no? Can an MTP be done for a 9 weeks blighted ovum? You can enter in the chat box if you don't want to unmute, either way. Anyone? Will this come under MTP, under the MTP Act? Yes or no? Anyone? Okay, someone's writing in the chat box. Let me check. Okay, so someone's written yes, but the actual answer is it's a blighted ovum. Okay, so it won't come under the MTP Act. You will anyway do a termination for such a patient. So this can come to confuse you. Okay, so a blighted ovum, a missed abortion, okay, a fetal demise, these don't come under the purview of the MTP Act, because the fetus is all anyway non-viable. Okay, so it is not a live fetus, it is not viable. So blighted ovum, missed abortions, and incomplete abortions and fetal demise will not come under the MTP Act. Okay, same for 23 weeks IUD. So someone else has written Okay. Oh, yes. Thank you. All right. Okay. Same 23 weeks IUD also will not come. Okay. Because we anyway have to terminate. It is not a viable fetus. It does not come under medical termination of pregnancy. Okay. So let's see. 22 weeks and carefully, can an MTP be done? Yes or no? So anyone in the chat box, you can enter if you don't want to unmute. 22 weeks and carefully, should we do an, can we do an MTP? 22 weeks woman comes with an MTP, someone has written. Yes, good. So you can do an MTP. That's very good. You can. And who should form the opinion? One RMP, two RMP, or medical board? Yes, okay. So you're all writing yes. One RMP, think again. One RMP or two RMP? Remember, one RMP was for less than 20 weeks. I'll repeat again. One RMP. So this is the new act, remember. Okay, less than 20 weeks, one RMP. 20 to 24 weeks, 2 RMP, and more than 24 weeks for a fetal anomaly, the medical board. Remember this, okay? So this has changed, okay? So this is what the change, one of the major changes, less than 20 weeks, 1 RMP, 20 to 24, 2 RMP, more than 24, medical board, okay? So 2 RMP, good, okay? Someone has written 2 RMP, all right? So this is one of the major changes, and the question can come like this. That's why I've put these scenarios, okay? Next. Why isn't this moving? One second. Okay, 28 weeks tetralogy of Fallot. Can we do an MTP? And who should form an opinion? 28 weeks tetralogy of Fallot. Okay, good. The medical board will decide. Okay, an MTP can be done if the medical board says so. It can be done, but it will go to the medical board. We can't take the decision. The patient says, no, I don't want to continue this pregnancy. My baby has this problem. We can't say yes or no. We just ask her to put an application to the medical board and we guide her accordingly. But yes, an MTP, if the medical board says yes, then yes, we can do a MTP. Okay. 26 weeks rape. Yes or no? 26 weeks rape? 26 weeks rape. Yes or no? 26 weeks. Remember what I said? After? Okay, someone said no. Good. Okay, so after 24 weeks only? After 24 weeks only for fetal anomaly. Okay, rape can come only up till 24 weeks. Okay, so after 24 weeks only for fetal anomaly. Okay, someone's written malformations. Okay, good. So 22 weeks contraceptive failure, yes or no? 22 weeks contraceptive failure, yes or no? Yes or no, anyone? Okay. No, good. Okay, so we can't do for contraceptive failure. The upper limit is only 20 weeks. Okay, so contraceptive failure, upper limit is 20 weeks. What has changed here is it is now applicable to married and unmarried women both. The initial law stated only married women, but now contraceptive failure till 20 weeks also in unmarried girls it is allowed. Okay, and I think second last 26 weeks dwarfism. The mother has dwarfism, which comes under significant disability, can she be allowed to have an MTP? Yes or no? The mother has, not the fetus. No. Okay, good. So, sorry, this has opened. Sorry. Yeah. So, dwarfism, no. Because again, remember, this is very clear now, I think, after 24 weeks, only fetal anomaly we can allow. All right. And the last one, 29 weeks, renal agenesis. The fetus has renal agenesis at 29 weeks. Yes or no? You diagnose fetal renal agenesis at 29 weeks. Yes or no? Anyone quickly? Okay. So no one is answering. But the answer is it will go again to the medical board. We won't decide. Okay, although bilateral renal agenesis is incompatible with life. Okay, so but the medical board has to decide what to do. But we will refer to the medical board. So please remember again, after 24 weeks for fetal anomaly, refer to the medical board. There is no upper limit for termination of pregnancy after 24 weeks. That's very important to remember. Okay. And the changes that have been made, I will repeat, less than 20 weeks. What is the major change? That we allow MTP for contraceptive failure even in unmarried women. 20 to 24 weeks, select conditions, we allow MTP, okay? And more than 24 weeks, we allow, that is, there's no upper limit for fetal anomalies, but that goes to the medical board. Less than 20 weeks, 1 RMP, 2024, 2 RMP, and more than 24, medical board. Form C is consent form, and this form is form I, form E, and form D, improvised explosive device. Okay, so I hope this this is very complete. This presentation should solve 100% of your questions which come on the MTP Amendment Act. If you have any doubts, you can ask me now, unmute or put in the chat box. Okay, and I have recorded this presentation, so I will be putting it up, so you can refer to this again. Okay, so I think that will be very helpful for all of you. Okay, so any doubts, please let me know. Ma'am, is there any minimum number of MTP a person must have assisted to conduct an MTP? Okay, so this was there in the previous act. Yes, there is a minimum number of 25 MTPs to be conducted to perform an MTP. Okay, I think I missed out this. It was in there in the previous act. 25 MTPs should be have conducted to be able to conduct a, to be able to be able to perform an MTP. And I'm glad you asked that because I had missed that. Not in the new one. No, in the new one, there's no change about this. There's nothing. They're not mentioning anything about the new one, about the this in the new MTP Act. So this probably remains the same. This has not been touched on. Okay. And this has come as a question earlier. I think it's my mistake. I should have put this 25 MTPs should have been done for to perform an MTP by an RMP. This is if they are only an MBBS. Okay. Anyone else? Okay, thank you, ma'am. All right. Okay, so I hope this session was helpful. Any doubts, you can put in the chat section or ask me on the WhatsApp group. Okay, thank you so much for your patient listening. And tomorrow we have a quiz on early pregnancy complications. So ectopic, molar, abortions, again, MTPs. Okay. These will be asked. Please spread the message to your friends. Please attend the quiz, half an hour quiz, 30 questions. Okay. And I will review the questions so there's no discrepancy this time. Last time there was some problem. Okay. So please tell all your friends to participate. And thank you very much.